This morning on Close Up, he enters a crowded GOP presidential field, but Ohio Governor John Kasich says he sets himself apart. We'll ask him why. And we sit down with Manchester mayoral candidate Joyce Craig as she describes the state of the city she'd like to run. Good morning, I'm Adam Sexton in for Josh McKelvin this Sunday. He's the latest to join the Republican presidential race, and after he announced this past week, he came to New Hampshire to talk with voters. So we sat down to talk with Ohio Governor John Kasich from outside one of his events. Governor Kasich, you thought about running in 2000 and then decided against it. This time around, you're the 16th candidate in the Republican field. What sets you apart from those candidates, and why now but not then?
Well, I think record and experience. I was the chairman of the budget committee when we balanced the budget, which is hard for people to believe. It was the first time that we balanced the budget since man walked on the moon, and we haven't done it since, and I was one of the chief architects of that. I'd spent 10 years of my life to get us to balance, and when we did it, the economy was doing well, and we cut taxes, and we paid down debt. And I also served on the Defense Committee for 18 years, so I have the foreign policy experience. And then, you know, I've been running a very big state as an executive, and we've gone from, you know, real terrible situation with the loss 350,000 jobs down, $8 billion in the hole, to where we're 350,000 jobs up, we're running surpluses, and we have the largest amount of tax cuts in the country at $5 billion. So that experience, I think, sets me apart, and the reason why I would do it now is because I think I can win. That's why.
You've got the backing of Senator Sununu.
I do.
Here in New Hampshire. I've heard a lot of establishment Republicans speaking very highly of you. There's a lot of excitement up there sort of at the upper levels of the party, but less so perhaps at the lower levels, the conservative activist base. How do you win over those more hardcore, harder right Republicans?
Well, I kind of don't distinguish the party, to tell you the truth, that way. I think everybody's kind of concerned about the same things. People want the budget balanced. They want a strong defense. They want the border rebuilt. I favor all of that. And, you know, and I think anybody can talk a good game, but I've delivered a good game, right? I mean, we balanced the federal budget. I was there. I was part of it. I was one of the chief people. We cut taxes on capital gains in Ohio. We've balanced budgets. We're running surpluses. Our credit is strong. And we've had the largest amount of tax cuts in the country. And we've had very significant reform of government. So, you know, I'll put my conservative credentials up against anybody else. But look, I'm just going to tell people who I am, and I'm not very concerned about it.
How does New Hampshire fit into your strategy in terms of getting to the White House?
Well, it's very important because I think New Hampshire, I mean, I think you realize it, but what's really terrific about it is, in a nutshell, you're the screener for the country. I mean, New Hampshire, you know, they measure you, they look at you, you have lots of meetings, they stare you in the eye, they ask you questions, and then they make a judgment. And it's my kind of politics. It's grassroots. It's doable here.
How important will organizing be to winning the New Hampshire primary, especially you have 16 candidates? You know, if you divide the number of votes that were cast.
Everybody
in the last
talks election. About so many yeah. candidates. The reason there's so many candidates in the race is because there's nobody who's a front runner. So, you know, that says that it's kind of wide open. Of course you have to be organized. You run a campaign from the bottom up, not the top down. Now, I've got some advertising on television here, and that's important because I want people to know who I am, and then they're going to have to see me. So, you know, these town halls and all these ways in which you come into contact with voters, if you don't have a strong organization, you're not going to do very well here.
You say there's no front runner, but the latest poll says otherwise in terms of Mr. Trump. Do you consider him a Republican?
Yeah, he calls himself a Republican. Why not? But when I say there's no front runner, when I talk to all the political people around here, and including Senator Sununu, who I think is one of the great, great people here in the state, there is nobody that's wrapped it up. If somebody, you know, had wrapped it up, we wouldn't have 16 people in the race, right? I mean, that's the reason. So the reason why, you know, people are like, wow, look at all the candidates. Well, it's because everybody thinks that maybe lightning can strike them. But I don't operate on a lightning strike in me basis, because that implies you don't have to work, you don't have to build an organization, you don't have to have a record. I don't think it works that way.
Is Mr. Trump good for this process, good for your party?
I'm not here to talk about any of the other candidates. I just don't have, you know, I have to do my thing, right? People still have to get to know me, and When they get to know me, then they can make a judgment, and it's not about my opinion of somebody else. I'd rather talk about my record.
All right, let's talk a little bit about the issues then. You're pro-life.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've seen this video that came out regarding the Planned Parenthood official over that lunch discussing a very sensitive
subject. I haven't,
subject,
but I know it's not a good thing.
Okay,
it's
yeah,
a terrible
so
thing.
In terms of this conversation, what does that video say about the abortion debate in America, do you think? And I think a lot of people are upset, essentially, about the tone that she took in describing...
I think everybody's upset about this on either side. I don't think they want to see this kind of stuff. As for my record, I've been pro-life. I am for exceptions of rape, incest, and life of the mother, but that's what I have to say about it.
That's a bit. I mean, you don't think there's a wider controversy here in terms of...
Oh, yeah, it's terrible, but I think everybody's sort of aghast. And in my state, there's laws against what these people had been talking about, and people violated the law. They should be prosecuted.
Does the next president need to be ready to go to war with Iran on day one?
No, I don't. What you mean, like a red line? Like we're going to go to war?
We've heard about this. I know you don't like talking about the other candidates, but there has been some discussion
about who needs to.
Do we need to be ready to fight on day one? Essentially,
first of all, we don't want to be drawing red lines and saying that on the first day that you're in office, you're going to go to war. It's not a very not a way to conduct foreign policy. I mean, look, I'm very concerned about this agreement. I hope the Senate will voice their strong opposition to it. I favored continued sanctions against Iran. The problem with this agreement, beyond just the fact that I don't think have very good inspections that are outlined in this deal, but they're not only going to be on the path to a nuclear weapon, but they're going to have a lot of money to support people who want to undermine all of our allies and would love to undermine us as well. Very bad agreement. So I think we need to monitor closely if it goes through. If we catch them cheating, we just have to be as tough as nails on this. But I would never have done this, but we'll see where we are over the period of the next few months. And maybe we'll get lucky, and maybe the Senate will point out some really terrible things about this. Maybe public opinion will turn significantly against this, and maybe they can override a presidential veto if the Senate votes this down. Let's hope that happens.
Do you think it's a moot point in terms of what America does? It seems like Israel might take its own action, perhaps, if it feels threatened.
Well, I wouldn't try to be predicting what another country would do. I don't know.
But is that, I mean, you're a strong supporter of Israel. I mean,
yeah.
Is that something, do you feel that they are more likely to have to act on their own, perhaps?
Well, I don't know what the Israeli intelligence is. I mean, they're our great ally, and we always support our ally. But I wouldn't be presuming what they're going to do. I mean, they're very, very upset about this. But let's not kind of get the cart way before the horse. Let's let things develop here. And again, I wouldn't agree with it. I wouldn't have ever done this. I think the administration fell in love with this idea. And when that happens, you're always going to get a bad result. And in terms of our friends in Israel, their security is critically important to us. But I would not want to be prejudging what they might do.
Back here on the home front, obviously, you've been a supporter of Medicaid and expansion back in Ohio, and we've talked about this before in previous interviews. But now that you've been out on the campaign trail a little bit, what are you hearing from local Republicans about Medicaid expansion and your support for it?
Well, what I tell them is that we have been able to figure out a way to from the moral side, but also from the fiscal side. We're now treating people who have mental illness and keeping them out of prison, which saves us money and I think is the right thing to do. We're in a position with the drug addicted where we're treating them in the prison and handing them off in the neighborhood, and there's a 10% recidivism rate, which is truly remarkable. And we're trying to make sure that people don't spend their time in the emergency room when they're sicker and more expensive. I've been very open with at the town halls about this, and normally people clap for me.
Mm-hmm. In terms of, you mentioned the moral issue there, and you've couched this in moral terms before.
It's a couple things. For me, I think it's important that those people who are poor, downtrodden, I'm a believer that when things are going better economically, everybody ought to be helped. Everybody ought to be given a start. But it also saves us a lot of money as well, because if they're not in prison, you save $22,500 a person. But I do think there's something immoral about locking up somebody who's bipolar or schizophrenic in a prison. I think you would agree with that, wouldn't you?
Well, it's not my...
Well, yeah,
I don't have to answer
your
question.
You're a person. You're a citizen. Why would we take somebody who's bipolar, who gets into a scuffle, and we lock them up in a prison cell? Now, that's not a very smart thing to do, particularly when we promised the mentally ill that once we closed the big institutions, we would take care of them in the community. And that's what we should be doing, and we broke our word on that. So I think it is important that that we give people, all of whom are created in the image of the Lord, a chance to get on their feet and be productive and live out their purpose here.
So if there is a moral imperative for healthcare, though, why not move just to a single-payer system where everyone has access?
Well, that's not the right way to run a healthcare system. I mean, we need to run a healthcare system that is a market-based system where the providers and insurance companies and your regular physician are in a position to be able to deliver you quality care, actually at a lower price. You need a shepherd to take you through what is a complex medical system. But we want to have insurance companies and providers working together to keep us healthy, and then if there are savings, to be able to share those savings. So the purpose is not to run a quantity-based healthcare system, but a quality-based healthcare system. And we're beginning that in Ohio.
You probably know more about the federal budget than anyone else running for president. What would you cut first? I mean, there's got to be, obviously, the entitlement programs, but is there an idea in your head of things that you could get rid of day one, day two, day three?
I've written about 16 budgets, and when you do this, you get yourself on a glide path. So first of all, you figure it's sort of like if you have a yard sale, you clean out the stuff you don't need anymore. Mm-hmm. So you do an inventory of what you might not need. But then you also take a look at things that you can send back to and empower local, like states, like, for example, K through 12 funding. We could send that back to New Hampshire or all the other states and let us run our education system. And then you have to deal with entitlements in such a way that it's fair, that people, where you can develop some bipartisan support. So, you know, what's most important is that you begin to work on a plan that's going to get bipartisan support, that gets us on a path to a balanced budget, because that's what's going to lead us to economic prosperity. It's not just about the numbers, and it's not just about the debt on our children, although that's another moral issue. But it really is fundamentally about getting this economy improving and humming, and so because we got to get people work. There are too many people that are out of work, and that's so critical to our families and our communities.
You were in Congress for about 20 years.
18.
About 20.
Don't make it worse than it was.
Historically, here in New Hampshire, people have thought highly of the idea of term limits. Is that a bad idea for Congress, or is that the institutional knowledge you gain over 20?
I support term limits at all levels.
Why?
Because I think it's good to have turnover.
Yeah. All right. Governor Kasich, anything else you'd like to add here before we...
Well, I tell you, I enjoy coming here, and the thing that is so special about this is I feel like everybody in New Hampshire kind of recognizes the importance of their role. So they get a chance to look at our record and look at our accomplishment and figure out if they think we can be the kind of leader that can, I believe, fundamentally create the economic growth and restore the economic dream or the American dream in this country so that everybody feels as though if they're a part of the opportunity in America, not just some, but everybody.
Governor, thanks so much for your time.
Always glad to do it. Thank you.